The following is a class on the Bhagavad Gita, as it is, second chapter, text number 19 through 25, given by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, recorded on December 4th, 1968, in Los Angeles.
For the soul, there is never birth or death. Nor having once been does he ever cease to be. He is unborn, eternal, and ever existing, undying and primeval.
These are the statements of Krishna. Now, the constitution of the soul, so far materialists are concerned, they cannot even find out where is the soul. Therefore, there are so many theories. Actually, they cannot find out where the soul is situated, because material senses cannot approach. The measurement of the soul is stated in the Vedic literature as 1/10,000 part of the tip of the hair. So there is no possibility of understanding what is soul by material scientists. The only process is to take it from higher authorities like Krishna. Krishna here gives definition of the soul, so we have to accept it. And not blindly accept it, but try to understand as far as possible with your arguments and reason. But this is the actual fact. Fact. What is that statement? The soul, definition of soul, Krishna is giving.
Only the material body, the indestructible, immeasurable, eternal living entity, is subject to destruction. He who thinks that the living entity is the slayer, or that the entity is slain, does not understand. One who is in knowledge knows that the self slays not, nor is slain.
Then, next.
20.
Yeah.
For the soul there is never birth or death. Nor having once been does he ever cease to be. He is unborn, eternal, ever-existing, undying and primeval. He is not slain when the body is slain.
Yes. Because eternal, therefore, how it can be slain? So, soul is never slain, the body is slain. Then?
21.
Yes.
O Partha, how can a person who knows that the soul is indestructible, unborn, eternal, and immutable kill anyone, or cause anyone to kill? Report. Everything has its utility, and a man who is situated in complete knowledge knows how and where to apply a thing for its proper utility. Similarly, violence also has its use, and how to apply violence rests with the person in knowledge. Although the justice of the peace awards capital punishment to a person condemned for murder, the justice of the peace cannot be blamed, because he ordered violence to another according to the code of justice. In the Manu Samhita, the law book for mankind, it is supported that a murderer should be condemned to death so that in his next life he will not have to suffer for the great sin he has committed. Therefore, the king's punishment of hanging a murderer is actually beneficial. Similarly, when Krishna orders fighting, it must be concluded that violence is for the supreme justice, and as such, Arjuna should follow the instruction, knowing well that such violence committed in the act of fighting for justice is not at all violent, because at any rate, the man or rather the soul, cannot be killed. For the administration of justice, so-called violence is permitted. A surgical operation is not meant to kill the patient, but is for his cure. Therefore, the fighting to be executed by Arjuna under the instruction of Krishna is with full knowledge, and so there is no possibility of sinful reaction.
This is the distinction between violence and non-violence. People are very much advocate of non-violence, but they are committing, according to their estimation, they are committing every moment violence. But from higher standard, there is practically no violence. The things which apparently appear to be violence, if it is properly executed, just like under the order of High Court judge, one body is being executed. So that is not violence. A justice of higher order is not meant for committing violence. It is justice. Similarly, when under the direction of the Supreme Justice, Krishna, anything is done, apparently it, although it appears violence, it is not violence, it is justice. This is the end.
22. As a person puts on a new garment, giving up old one, similarly the soul accepts new material bodies, giving up the old and useless one. Purport.
In a different way, in varied ways, Krishna is trying to make us understand the constitutional position of the soul. Yes.
Change of body by the atomic individual soul is an accepted fact. Even some of the modern scientists who do not believe in the existence of the soul, at the same time cannot explain the source of energy from the heart. They have to accept continuous changes of body which appear from childhood to boyhood, and from boyhood to youth, and again from youth to old age. From old age, the change is transferred to another body. This has already been explained in the previous verse. Transference of the atomic individual soul to another body is also made possible by the grace of the super soul. The super soul fulfills the desire of the soul as one friend fulfills the desire of another. The Vedas, such as the Mandaka Upanishad, as well as the Svetasvatara Upanishad, confirm this concept of two kinds of souls by comparing them to two friendly birds sitting on the same tree. One of the birds, the individual atomic soul, is eating the fruit of the tree, and the other bird is simply watching his friend. Of these two birds, although they are the same in quality, one is captivated by the fruits of the material tree, while the other is simply witnessing his activity. Krishna is the witnessing bird, and Arjuna is the eating bird. Although they are friends, one is still the master, and the other is the servant.
That is the eternal relationship. These are confirmed in Vedic literature, just like Svetasvatara Upanishad, Mandukya Upanishad. The system is, whatever is mentioned in the Vedas, that is authoritatively accepted. That is the Vedic understanding. If there is some evidence in the Vedas, just like in law court, if there is some section in the law book, then the lawyers, the judge accept it. Yes, it is like this. Similarly, knowledge, Vedas means knowledge. So perfect knowledge is there. Therefore, if the evidence is there in the statement of Vedas, that is the proof, sabda praman. there are three kinds of evidences, pratyaksha, direct sense perception, and sabda praman, evidence from the Vedic statement, and anumana, aitijya, historical or hypothesis. So, out of all evidences, the evidence which is called derived from Vedic statement, that is accepted as most authoritative. Therefore, Mandukya Upanishad and Shvetashvatara Upanishad, they are Vedas. There is statement that two birds are sitting on the same tree. The tree is compared, the body is compared with the tree. And two birds, namely the Super Soul, Krishna, and the living entity, individual soul, they are sitting together. And one is eating the fruit of the tree, and the other is simply witness. This is our position. The other friendly bird, Krishna, or Super Soul, is giving us opportunity to act with this body as I like. He's giving us opportunity. Khetraka. I am the proprietor of this body. I have been allowed to utilize this body as I like. And the facility is given by the Super Soul. So if I like, I can utilize this body for higher grade of life. Krishna will give us all facilities. And if I like, I can utilize this body for lower grade of life. Krishna will give us facilities. See, he is always friendly. And he gives us also friendly advice that don't act independently. Just act in Krishna consciousness under me, then you will be happy. That is his actual instruction. But the living entity does not care for the instruction of the Super Soul. He wants to act independently and he has to suffer the consequence. That is stated in the Bhagavad Gita in the 4th chapter. Yajna chitarmanna tru lupayam karma bandhana. Yajna means Vishnu or Krishna. Whatever you do, or whatever you do, you have to do only for Krishna. Yajna se karma. Whatever you act, never mind, whatever you do. But you have to act for Krishna. Yajnatha karma anatra. Otherwise, karma bandhana. You will be bound up by the reaction. The same example, a person acting on behalf of some superior authority, government, personally he has no responsibility. Because he is acting on behalf of the supreme authority. Just like a manager or agent, attorney. Just like we signed one lease agreement. Then Mr. Brown, he is acting as attorney on behalf of the landlord. So, he has no responsibility. He is acting in landlord capacity. Your landlord consciousness. He is trying to save the interests of the landlord as far as possible. But if there is any mistake, the landlord will suffer again. He has nothing to do. Similarly, if we work in Krishna consciousness, if there is something wrong, because we can act two ways, wrongly or rightly, that's all. If we do rightly, it is all right. Even if we don't do it rightly, wrongly, still it is right. Because the cause is the supreme. Jagyate karmanatru lupayam karmavanda. The best, safest way of acting is to act in Krishna consciousness or under the order of Krishna. If somebody says, where is Krishna? No, for Krishna is there, just like Bhagavad Gita is there. And the explanation of Bhagavad Gita by the representative of Krishna is there. So Krishna being absolute, he is representative, his words are non-different from him. We should not think that Krishna is not in my presence. As soon as Bhagavad Gita is there, and as soon as we understand Bhagavad Gita as it is, that means we are hearing directly Krishna. So if we do, according to the instruction of Krishna, as Arjuna did, then there is no reaction. We are free. Jagyate karmanat. Then,
although they are friends, one is still the master and the other is the servant.
This friend is giving us facility. Krishna is always our friend, natural friend. That is stated in the Bhagavad Gita. Suhidam sarvabhutanam. Suhidam means suhit. There are different kinds of friends. But here, in Sanskrit, for different kinds of friends, there are different names. Just like one friend is called Bandhu, one is called Mitra, one friend is called Sweet. There are differences. Therefore, there are different words. Just like in English language, there is only one friend, a word, one word friend. But in Sanskrit, because it is perfect language, friend, what kind of friend? So Krishna says that I am Suhidam Sarvabhutam. Suhid means he is such a friend, just like you have got a friend, sincerely he wants how you shall be helped. Just like your mother. Mother is also friend. Or wife, devoted wife, she is also friend. So mother, wife, or any such relative, or father, or there are many persons in our ordinary relationship. So they want actually that this friend be happy. That is real friend, sweet. And mitra, social friendship. Bandhu, official friendship. But sweet means one who actually desires good of his friend. Sincere friend, which is described in English. So Krishna is sweet. He is always expecting my good. How I shall be good. And therefore he is canvassing me. You surrender to me, just like father says, my dear boy, why you are acting independently, foolishly, you are suffering? Just surrender unto me, I shall give you protection. Similarly, Krishna is friend like that. He is always asking. He is going with me in any type of body. Even if I get the body of a dog, Krishna is always there. Ish, that is stated in Bhagavad Gita. Ishara sarva-bhutana riddhesa arjuna tishtati. Ishara, the Supreme Lord, is staying within the heart of every living entity. So every living entity means he is staying even with the cats, dogs, hogs, or any lower type of animal. He has no hesitation. Because he is not living with him. He is living in Vaikuntha. But he is so friendly that wherever this friend is going, he is also going there. Paramatma, he is doing friendly activities. He is standing, he is bona fide servant, a spiritual master. He is coming as incarnation. He is coming as devotee, Lord Chaitanya. He is helping us in so many ways. But we are so foolish, we are not accepting. Nobody can be better friend than Krishna. But we are so much unfortunate, so much captivated by the external energy that we don't accept Krishna as friend. We accept so many other things as friend. Go on.
Forgetfulness of this relationship by the atomic soul is the cause of one changing his position from one tree to another, or from one body to another.
Now, here, he's giving trouble to the friend. I am giving to my sincere friend Krishna simply trouble, just like a bird is flying from one tree to another. The friend bird is also there. He has no business, he has no interest to be there, because he is not eating anything from the tree. He has nothing to do, but because his friend is there, he goes. So, we are changing our body as the bird, the changing from one tree to another. But Krishna, the supreme bird, is also going with me.
The jiva, the soul, is struggling very hard on the tree of the material body. But as soon as he agrees to accept the other bird as the supreme spiritual master,
then here is the solution. He's simply taking unnecessary trouble. Krishna says that I will supply you everything. There is no necessity of going from here to there. No. But I am not accepting it. Tattadiham punarjanma naiti mami iti kanta. One who understands this, how Krishna is helping me, how he is my the greatest well-wisher, friend, immediately we can stop all these problems of life and go back to Godhead, go back to home.
But as soon as he agrees to accept the other bird, the supreme spiritual master, as Arjuna has agreed to do, by voluntary surrender unto Krishna for instruction, the subordinate bird immediately becomes free from all limitation.
Yes. Both as Arjuna has accepted, Arjuna was talking with Krishna as friend, but he has accepted. Although his friend, he has accepted his spiritual master. The significance is that as soon as you accept somebody as spiritual master, you cannot argue. You have to accept. Therefore, the selection of spiritual mastery is very scrutinizing. You cannot accept anyone as spiritual master. You must be very much satisfied that here is a person who can solve the problems of my life, just like Arjuna thought. He plainly said that the problem which is before me, I know beyond you, besides you, nobody can make solution. That is the way of accepting spiritual master. When one is fully convinced that here is a person who can actually solve the problems of my life, then one should accept spiritual master. In the Hari Bhakti Vilas, there is such process that one should accept a spiritual master after associating with him for some time. Similarly, the spiritual master also shall accept somebody as disciple after associating with him for some time, whether he is eligible or not. This is the process. Go on.
23. The soul can never be cut into pieces by any weapon, nor can he be burned by fire, nor moistened by water, nor withered by the wind.
This is the distinction of the soul being spirit. You take anything on this material world, they can be burnt. It is the question of temperature only. Even iron is being burnt, any metal, any hard thing, stone is being burnt, everything is being burnt. But here it is said that a soul cannot be burnt. So does it mean that it is stronger than iron and stone? But it is very fragmental, minute, atomic portions. But it cannot be burned. So all these symptoms cannot be burned, cannot be cut into pieces. Here the Mayavadi theory will fail. If the soul cannot be cut into pieces, then how the soul has become enwrapped with Maya? They give the example, Ghatakas, Patakas. Of course, they say that it is covered, it is cut, is not cut into pieces, but the soul is separated, I mean to say, separate identity constitutionally. That will be confirmed in the 15th chapter, Mamim Bhangsa Jiva. Sanatana. Sanatana means eternal. Eternally, the example, just like fire and fire spark, the fire spark are part and parcel of the fire. Similarly, the soul, individual soul, is part and parcel of the Supreme, but that part and parcel is eternal. Not that being covered by Maya, it has become individual. No. Individual permanently. Permanently individual. As God is permanently individual, so every one of us living entity, we are permanent. It is not that by Maya we have been separated, cut into pieces, fragments. It is clearly stated, it cannot be cut. If this is not, cannot be cut, then how I have become fragment? That I am not cut fragment, I am eternal fragment. That is confirmed in the 15th chapter, Sanatana, eternal. Try to understand. Just like you take a paper, you cut into pieces, that is cut. But here it is said that the spirit cannot be cut. Then how you have become fragments, pieces, different individuals? That means you are eternally so. Or eternally individual. It is not that by the influence of Maya you have been cut into pieces. No. Here it is said, it cannot be cut. Another, it cannot be burnt. If you study one verse of Bhagavad Gita, you understand so many things. Now it cannot be burnt. Now if it cannot be burnt, then in fire also there is soul. They materially say that in the sun glow, it is impossible to have living entities there. No, because it cannot be burned. So impossible. So this Vedic knowledge that sun planet is a planet just like other planets, and it is fiery, and the residents are also fiery body, so why one should be astonished that there is living entity? Why they should deny that there is no living entity? They are denying that in the moon planet also there is no living entity. Why? Why? Living entity can be everywhere. Sarvago, this very word has been used in Bhagavad Gita. Sarvaga, he'll find it. Sarvaga means he can go everywhere. He can go live in the fire also. And actually we see that in the air there is living entity, in the water there is living entity, in the land there is living entity. So why not in the fire? Fire is one of the elements like air, water, land. So if in other elements there is possibility of living beings, why not in one? What is the reason? What is the argument? And Vedic literature gives us information that in the fire there is germ also. Just like water there is germ, in the earth there is germ, in the air there is germ, living entities. Similarly in the fire there is germ. And here it is said, it cannot be burned. Even it is in the fire, there is no possibility of being burned. So why not in the fire? It requires a different type of body only, that's all. Just like the fish, it has got a different type of body. It is living very comfortably in the water. You have got a different type of body. You are living in the land very comfortably. You cannot live in the water. The fish cannot live in the land. Similarly, in the fiery planet, just like sun, there must be living entity. There must be. You cannot say by any reason that there is no living entity. How you can say? If it is a fact, that living entity cannot be burned. Is it not? Just try to understand. Yes.
24.
Yes.
This individual soul is unbreakable, insoluble.
Unbreakable, again. The Mayavadi theory that it has broken parts by Maya. No, unbreakable. That means eternally we are individual, separate. Just like we are sitting. All individuals. This is your eternal position. Krishna has confirmed it. That Arjuna, yourself, myself, and all these people who are assembled here, they're all individuals. They existed in the past and they continue to exist in the future. So, this is a confirmed truth that every living entity is individual. And Krishna is also individual. And that is also stated in the Vedas. Nitya nityanam chetana chetanana. He is the chief of all these individual living entities. That is the difference. He is the chief. Just like you have accepted me, the chief of your group. But that does not mean in all other respects we are all one. You have got the same feeling, I have got the same feeling. You have selected me or I have got some extraordinary qualification, I am controlling you. Similarly, Krishna has got the extraordinary quality by which he can control the whole situation. Otherwise, he is as individual as you are. The supreme controller, we use this word. That's all. Krishna is just like we are sitting face to face. Krishna is like that. You can have that opportunity. Just like Arjuna had the opportunity. Similarly, you will have the opportunity. You have to take the opportunity. You will see Krishna face to face, talk with him face to face, play with him face to face. It is so nice, Krishna consciousness. Yes. Wow.
He is everlasting, all-pervading, unchangeable, immovable, and eternally
established. Everlasting, this is the place. Everlasting, then why I am not everlasting now? So this is my disease condition. People should take it like this. Here it is stated that the living entity is everlasting, but my present position is not everlasting. I am temporary. So why shall I be in this temporary, such abominable condition? I am everlasting. They are so rascal fools, they do not search out how he can be everlasting. They are trying to want his body, that's all. Everlasting body, by ointment, you see. That is not possible. That is their foolishness. They are trying to make this body by so-called science everlasting. That will never be possible. Your everlasting position is that you are spirit soul. You have to transfer yourself in that heavenly condition. Not this disease, and this is disease. My birth and death is disease. You have to cure this disease. That is your problem, real problem. But they are not serious about curing, solving this real problem, birth and death. They are thinking, so long I live, let me enjoy senses as far as possible, and let me enjoy. That's it. Philosophy. Child philosophy. Just like child does not look forward his future. He is very playful. He sees that this playing will make me happy. Similarly, these rascals, they are simply enjoying senses, forgetting their future life. So this is a rascal civilization. This is not a good civilization. Childly civilization. However, they may be proud of their advancement of knowledge. It is childly civilization because they have no future. Everlasting, how I am going to be everlasting? They do not think of it. This one word can give so many volumes of thoughts to the real philosopher, to the real thinker. But here it is stated that the living entity is everlasting. And where is that living entity, everlasting? Why it is not so? This is the problem.
It is said that the soul is invisible, inconceivable.
Yes, invisible, that is a fact. I am soul, you are soul, but I cannot see with these eyes. I am seeing your body, just like I am seeing my son or husband or brother. And as soon as my son or husband or son, anyone dies, oh, my son is gone. Oh, where is your son gone? He's lying here. Why do you say gone? No, he's gone. He's gone. Then what is that son? Have you ever seen him? That is the problem. He has never seen his son or husband. He has seen his body, his husband or son or father. They are invisible. You cannot see even a small particle of soul which is spiritual. You want to see God immediately without preparing your eyes. They want to see God. They cannot see even the small particle of God, the soul, and they want to see immediately God. Yes. One can see God, but not immediately. You have to prepare your eyes. You'll see God, you'll see soul, everything. Everything will be visible. At the present moment, it is invisible. Because we have got material eyes. With material eyes, we cannot see anything spiritual. It is blocked.
Knowing this, you should not grieve for the body.
Yes, because we cannot see, just like the same example, a man is dead, his little is crying, he says he's gone, he's still seeing, the body is there. That means he has never studied who is his little. Then at least he must know after death that this body is not my relative. Something else. Beyond this body.
As described above, the magnitude of the soul is such that through our material calculation it cannot be detected even by the most powerful microscope. Therefore, he is invisible. As far as his existence is concerned, nobody can establish his experimental stability beyond the proof of Shruti, of Vedic wisdom.
Yes. Now here Krishna says that don't care for this body, there is soul. That is Shruti. Shruti means you hear from Krishna, then you understand. Otherwise there is no possibility to understand. They take an example, as I have several times said, that who is your father, that you can understand simply by hearing from your mind. That's all. The mother says, he is your father. What is the evidence? Hearing from the mouth. That's all. Similarly, anything spiritual, a spiritual identity, spiritual God, spiritual kingdom, you have to learn simply by hearing from authority. There is no other process. There is no other second process. Simply we have to hear. Just the same example. Who is your father? You have to simply believe your mother. Even if we, of course, it is not expected that she will give a false information. Understanding the father, mother is nice, she will give me. So that is the only way. You have to believe your mother, and that's all. Similarly, if you want to understand anything spiritual, you have to take information by hearing from such authorities as Krishna or his principle. And there is no other alternative. Other alternative, it will ever remain invisible and not understandable and so many things. Negative. Yes.
We have to accept this truth because there is no other source for understanding the existence of the soul. Although it is a fact by perception. There are many things we have to accept solely on grounds of superior authority. No one can deny the existence of his father based on the authority of his mother. There is no other source for understanding.
Now, everyone knows that when I am born, there must have been somebody my father. This is the conclusion. And now who is my father? That is evidence to be taken from mother. Similarly, nobody can deny the existence of God. Because everything has got a father, generator. So therefore, this whole creation, there must be a generator. Now, how we can see the father? Through the mother, Veda. As we understand our father through the mother, similarly, through the mother of Vedic knowledge, you can understand what is God. Come on.
Similarly, there is no other source of understanding the soul except by studying the Vedas.
Yes.
In other words, the soul is inconceivable to human experimental knowledge. The soul is consciousness, and consciousness, that also is the statement of the Vedas. And we have to accept that. Unlike the bodily changes, there is no change for the soul. As eternally unchangeable, he remains atomic always, in comparison to the infinite supreme soul.
Yes. Unchangeable means the Mahavad theory that now I am finite, I shall become infinite. That's wrong. How it can be? Eternal. Eternally finite, eternally remains infinite. We cannot be equal with God, the infinite. That is not possible. He'll have to remain as subordinate.
The supreme soul is infinite, and the atomic soul is infinitesimal. Therefore, the infinitesimal soul, being unchangeable, can never become equal to the infinite soul.
Yes, this is a common sense argument. How it can be? If it is equal to the infinite, how he has become finite? They cannot answer. The impersonalists cannot answer. How he has become finite? Then simply the answer is, it is Maya. Then Maya is greater than the infinite. Then Maya becomes greater than the infinite. Then that God is never infinite, because Maya covers the Supreme. So how is he is infinite? He becomes finite. The common sense is that finite Brahma is covered by Maya, not the infinite. Therefore, duality, finite and infinite, living entity. Krishna is infinite and living, ordinary living entity. What is that?
Ice cream.
You are taking ice cream?
No, they
don't. Canvassing?
Yes.
Don't take ice cream. This is Maya. Come on, enjoy me. Come on, enjoy me. As soon as you enjoy, become entrapped. That's all. That's like fishing tackle. They throw the tackle and invite the fish. Come on, enjoy me. Come on, enjoy me. As soon as finished. Then, oh, where do you go now? Come on, in my bag. Yes, I'll try you next. So, these are all explained in the Srimad Bhagavatam. The fish is losing his life by eating my tongue. He cannot check the dictation of the tongue, therefore he is losing his life. Okay. Similarly, the animals, deer, in the jungle, the hunter, they play very nice flute, and all of them assemble to hear how it is nice, and then he keeps him in the trap. Loses his life. That means hearing. Tasting, hearing. And the elephant is caught by sexual. Do you know how elephant is captured? Yes. A sea elephant is trained, goes to the male elephant, and it follows, and the male elephant is dropped into what's called big pot, pit, yes. And then he remains there for some time, then he's tackled and he's taken out. In this way, there are different examples of senses. It is called that black. What is that? Brahma, English? That black big fly? Oh. Maybe. It is entrapped by smelling lotus flower within the lotus flower, yes, and loses its life. So, by different sense gratification, the different kinds of animals are losing their life. And we have got all our senses active. So where do we are? These examples are for animal kingdom, whose one sense is only active. But our all senses are active. Then what is our position? You see? This example is given in the Bhagavad. A man has got 6 wives and he has entered the house and all the wives have captured him. You come to my room. You see? So one has taken his one hand, another has taken another hand, one has taken his one leg, one has taken and see, he's like this. What's the leg? You see? So, this is our position. Human being, whether they shall control the senses, instead of controlling the senses, they're becoming servant of senses and losing this great opportunity of human life. Yeah.
And people that are concerned with advancing to the higher planet, do they have more opportunities to become entrapped?
No, anyone within this material world, they're entrapped by the sense enjoyment, either in higher planets or lower planets. Just like animal kingdom, there is sense impetus, and human being also. What is human being? We are civilized being. What we are doing? The same thing. Eating, sleeping, mating. The same thing. As the dog is doing. So anywhere in the material world, either in the higher planet or in the lower planet, this sense gratification is prominent. Only in the spiritual world there is no sense gratification. There is simply an endeavor to satisfy Krishna. That here everyone is trying to satisfy his senses. That is the law of material. That is material life. So long you try to satisfy your senses, that is your material life. And as soon as you turn yourself to satisfy the sense of Krishna, that is your spiritual life. It's a very simple thing. Instead of satisfying Rishikena, Rishikesa, Sevanam, that is bhakti. You have got senses. You have to satisfy. Senses, with senses you have to satisfy. Either you satisfy yourself, but you do not know. The conditioned soul does not know that satisfying the Krishna senses, his senses will be automatically satisfied. The same example, just like pouring water to the root or the fingers, part and parcel of my body, giving foodstuff here to this stomach, automatically the fingers will be satisfied. These secrets we are missing. We are thinking we shall be happy by trying to satisfy our senses. Krishna consciousness means don't try to satisfy your senses, you try to satisfy the senses of Krishna, automatically your senses will be satisfied. This is the secret of Krishna consciousness. The opposite party, they are thinking, why shall I satisfy, why shall I work for Krishna? The whole day and night. Let me try for the karmis. Just like you are working whole day and night for Krishna, they are thinking, what fools they are. We are very intelligent. We are working for our own sense gratification whole day and night. And why they are working for Krishna? This is the difference between materialist and spiritualist. The spiritualist endeavor is to work whole day and night, strenuously, without any heart, simply for Krishna. That is spiritual. And the materialist means the same endeavor, always trying to satisfy their personal sense. That is the difference, materialistic and spiritual. So, Krishna consciousness movement means that we have to train our senses to satisfy Krishna. That's all. So long, in our previous many, many thousands and millions of lives, we have simply tried to satisfy our senses, personal senses, Let this life be dedicated for satisfying Krishna. That is it. One life. We have several lives we have tried to satisfy our personal senses. Let this life, at least one life, let me try for them. So we are not losers. Even we feel inconvenienced by not satisfying our senses, that we are not losers. Try simply to satisfy Krishna's senses.
We're reading about the sixth chapter in Bhagavad Gita now. And should I wait till you come to that chapter, or should I ask you a question while I come to that chapter?
As you like.
It mentions the Hayana and Vajra Yoga in that chapter. Can you explain the meaning of these two yogas? Dhyana.
Dhyana.
Dhyana
yoga. Meditation.
Is Raja yoga the same?
Yeah.
Both meditation.
Yeah. Sitting in the lecture. Everybody, that's what you said, that everybody in the material world is in Maya. But that you can't be in Maya.
How do you think? What do you think?
You're spiritual, so you can't be in Maya.
How do you think that I am not in Maya?
Because
you're a pure devotee. You see Krishna in everybody. Yes. Then a pure devotee is not in Maya. Do you agree to that? Mm-hmm. So, are you going to be a pure devotee?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But you are going to be, trying to be. That's all right. That's all right. That's all right. Yes.
In Bhagavad Gita it says that we are one in the spirit soul, I spirit soul, and 1/10,000th of the foot of the hair. We are very small, 1/10,000th of the hair. Well, if we are unchangeable, does Krishna change his size to be the same size as us so that we can associate with him when we go back to the spiritual world?
Yes.
Is it true that you want to say something about the superstar being the size of the sun? Or is that information that's right? Is the size of the sun
a
human being?
Yes.
In the Chaitanya Shatavatra, you wrote that Krishna has no arm or leg, and we have arms and legs. And his spiritual body is, and the other is the same. His spiritual body and...
He has got spiritual arms. Spiritual legs. I never said that he has no arms or legs. Yes, that is the statement in the Vedas, Apani Pada Javana Grahita. The Supreme Lord has no legs and hands, but still he accepts whatever we offer. Now we are accepting, we are offering here, Kutsa, Krishna. So it is confirmed that he accepts. Now he is, we do not know how far away he is staying in Vaikuntha Loka. There is no limit of measurement. then how is he accepting? It is said that Javana, he is accepting our offering, but he must be accepting with his hands. So he can stretch his hand so many millions and trillions miles away. Therefore, when it is said that he has no hand, that means he has no hand like us, limited. But that does not mean he has no hand. He has hand, unlimited. Unlimitedly he can stretch. That he cannot conceive. Because we have got these 3 feet, and so Krishna must have at least 4 or 3 feet, that's all. A proud philosophy. Simply imagining, Krishna may be very great, so we have got these 3 feet, Krishna, let him have 6 feet, that's all. But we cannot imagine how long his hand is. Therefore, his hand cannot be compared with this material hand. He has no material hand. That is it, not son of Veda. But he has a hand. That you cannot measure. Just like Arjuna could not measure when he saw the universal form. So, abhijananti mangmu ramanasati, therefore Krishna says, because I am moving amongst them as ordinary human being, they are thinking of me as one of them. And param bhavam ajanam. They do not know what is my background. Param bhavam. Therefore, they fail to understand me. Mura, rascals, fools. Everyone is trying to understand Krishna from the angle of vision as he can understand. Krishna is beyond that, therefore his name is Adokhaja, beyond the limit. He can simply be presented by himself, revealed, just like Krishna is revealing himself to Arjuna. Arjuna is not understanding Krishna by his philosophical speculation. Directly Krishna revealing. This is the process of understanding God. You cannot create your imagination, imaginative God, no. God reveals unto you, being pleased upon you by your devotional attitude. Sevan mukhihi jivhadu, just like Krishna says to Arjuna, vaktosi, priyosi, you are my very dear friend, you are my devotee, therefore I will reveal unto you. Not to others. This is the qualification of understanding God, to become devotee. So, our movement is to make people, in general, devotee. Then he'll understand God. Then his life will be successful. That's all. You be yourself devotee and try to make others devotee. Then both your life and the person who is under your instruction, he, everyone, is successful. And without being devotee, you cannot make others devotee. That is all the secret. If you remain non-devotee, you cannot convince others. That is not in your power. Therefore, the non-devotee class of men, they cannot understand God, they cannot convince others about God. That's the fact. They simply present hodgepodge thing, they do not understand clearly, and they present hodgepodge. Yes. Without being, bhaktyamam abhijanati javan jasyami tattva. If anyone wants to understand me as I am, of course nobody can understand Krishna as he is. He's still, as far as possible. That is only through bhakti, bhaktya. It is stated in the Bhagavad Gita. It doesn't say that through knowledge, philosophical speculation of through Hatha Yoga system, no. He says bhaktya, clearly. And in the beginning also he says, because you are my bhakta, therefore I shall reveal to you. The whole science is for the devotee, not for anyone. Those who are not devotees, their understanding of God is blocked forever. They cannot understand. It is a fact. Therefore Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, Mayavadi bhashya sunile hai sadvanas. If anyone tries to understand this impersonalist Mayavadi philosopher, then progress is blocked for good. Not for good, of course, nothing can be for good. But for the present at least, his progress is blocked. Sarvanas. Hare Krishna.